Hello, my name is Amy Shapiro, and I'm the Director of Programming and Engagement at the Anderson Collection at Stanford University. Thank you for joining us today for a conversation on Hostile Terrain 94, co-sponsored by the Anderson Collection and the Bill Lane Center for the American West. Captioning is available. Please click on the closed caption icon at the bottom to use this feature. First, I would like to acknowledge that Stanford sits on the territory of the Huichin, the ancestral and unceded land of the Mwakma Ohlone tribe, who are the successors of this historic and sovereign Verona Bard of Alameda County. This land was and continues to be of great importance to the Ohlone people. We recognize that every member of the community has benefited and continues to benefit from the use and occupation of this land. Consistent with our values of community and diversity, we have a responsibility to acknowledge and make visible the university's relationship to Native people. Our country has just witnessed one of the most contentious presidential elections in American history. The past 2 days have been a whirlwind as we all anxiously await the results of what is to come for the next 4 years. Over the last 4 years, President Trump enacted travel bans on majority Brown and Muslim countries, attempted to end the Deferred Action for Childhood Arrivals, or DACA program, and instated a zero tolerance order on unlawful immigration across the US-Mexico border, which resulted in the traumatizing and inhumane action of separating parents from their children. It has been a ruthless time for immigrants. Hostile Terrain 94 does not address these political orders and actions directly. Instead, it brings forward the names of those impacted, affected, and often not spoken about. Jason DeLeon, anthropologist and professor at UCLA, has made sure that thousands of people see these names. His installation, Hostile Terrain 94, is being exhibited at over 100 institutions across the world, including here at the Anderson Collection at Stanford University. 2 years after initial planning began, the Anderson Collection is proud to host this important, impactful, and powerful project. What you see here is the exhibit installed at the museum. Dozens of volunteers filled out tags of the names of migrants who perished while crossing the border from Mexico into Arizona. Each tag on this wall represents a life lived, someone with a family, a story, and a dream of a better life. As one fills out these details, you come across those with names, causes of death, and locations where people were found. You also come across too many tags marked as unidentified with details unknown. As I filled these out, my heart broke over and over again as I wrote the names of people aged anywhere from their 50s to a young boy of just 14. These lives are important and deserve to be known. Museum staff, university instructors, and students hung the more than 3,200 tags across a map of the Arizona-Mexico border that is depicted on the wall. As a museum, we hope to bring this issue to a wider audience. We want those names to be seen and spoken, those lives to be pondered, and the humanity of migration to not be degraded down to numbers and government policies. We are so honored today to be joined by our guest, Jason DeLeon, curator of Hostile Terrain 94, executive director of the Undocumented Migration Project and author, as well as Stanford's own Angela Garcia, associate professor of anthropology and author, who works at the intersection of social and political theory, ethics, medicine, literature, postcolonial, and feminist thought. We will also be joined by two Stanford students, John Ayon Alonso and Eklin Ho, both of whom have written for the publication accompanying the exhibition, which you can find in both English and Spanish on the museum's website. Koji Laozawa is a PhD candidate in the Department of Anthropology here at Stanford. His work focuses on the archaeology of the Japanese diaspora, particularly in Japanese internment camps, examining the material connections and landscapes of Japanese American communities. The Anderson Collection is incredibly grateful to Koji for bringing this project to the museum's attention and working tirelessly to see it through to fruition. Please use the Q&A function on the bottom of your screen throughout the event, as we'll be taking questions at the end of the panel. The Anderson Collection hopes to welcome you all to the museum to see Hostile Terrain 94 when we reopen in 2021. I will now hand it over to Koji, who will introduce our speakers and moderate the panel.
Thank you so much for that introduction, Amy. Good evening, everyone, and welcome to our event, a conversation on Hostile Terrain 94 with Jason De Leon and Angela Garcia. My name is Koji Lau Zhao, and as Amy said, I am a PhD candidate here at Stanford University in the Department of Anthropology, and I study the archaeology of Japanese diaspora. And it was my great pleasure to help bring this project to Stanford and the work of the Undocumented Migration Project here in Hostile Terrain 94 and work with so many great collaborators on campus and in the wider Bay Area community. And without further ado, I'd like to introduce two of our speakers tonight, Jason De Leon and Angela Garcia. Jason is a professor of anthropology and Chicano, and Central American studies at University of California, Los Angeles. He is the executive director of the Undocumented Migration Project, a nonprofit research, arts, and education collective committee to documenting and raising awareness about the experiences of border crossers globally. He's also the head curator of the Hostile Terrain 94 exhibition, the president and of the board of directors of the Calibri Center for Human Rights. He's currently working on a book titled Soldiers and Kings that examines the lives of Honduran smugglers crossing Mexico. Angela Garcia is an associate professor of anthropology here at Stanford. She is the author of The Pastoral Clinic, Addiction Dispossession Along the Rio Grande, published by UC Press. She is also currently working on a book called The Annex, which examines Mexico City's vast underground of coercive drug treatment centers and the families who run and depend on them. So welcome, Jason and Angela. And I'd like to just start off by inviting you to speak a little bit about your own work. Jason, if you'd like to go first and tell us a little bit about what you're working on.
Sure. First off, I just want to say thank you to Stanford, to Amy and to Koji and everyone at the museum for making this happen. I'm sad that I can't be there in person, but you know, I hope that we can all reconnect soon in the physical realm. But we're excited and that, you know, this exhibition has still managed to happen and people have been able to engage with it. And I think in a lot of ways, you know, the virtual programming has made this a lot more accessible. So I think that there really has been a lot of good that's come from this. And I'm just deeply appreciative and thankful for all the work that you've all done on your side of things. I also just want to say, I hope that everybody's doing okay right now. I spent the day eating candy, watching YouTube videos about guitar equipment and reading trashy novels. So whatever it is that you do to feel okay, I hope you're getting a chance to do that. And you know, when we were planning this event, we were wondering what the tone was gonna be for this, you know, given the timing. And I think in a lot of ways, the fact that we are so split right now in this country speaks to the important work that anthropologists, social scientists, historians, everybody who works on these issues needs to be continuing with, and to educate the public and to try to help improve our understanding of our shared experience. And I would say, you know, just from my own perspective, you know, I've been working on immigration issues since around 2009, and my work really evolves around the experiences of border crossers leaving Latin America and attempting to enter the United States. I wear a lot of hats. Sometimes I'm an archaeologist who looks at the things migrants leave behind. I'm an ethnographer who spends a lot of time with people trying to understand and document their experiences. I've delved into the realm of forensic science to understand the things that happen to those who die while crossing the US-Mexico border. And all of the social science work that I've done, you know, I've really tried to connect with with translating the work for different public audiences through various formats. And so whether that's, you know, trying to write accessibly, much like Angela Garcia does, which I hope we can talk a bit about writing in this current moment. But also, you know, trying to translate the stuff into things like museum exhibitions, like Hostile Terrain 94 and other work. And so for me, you know, my work is concerned with raising awareness about what happens to border crossers during their experiences, how border crossing is connected to larger sociopolitical, political, economic issues, you know, really trying to demystify the process for a general public, but then also trying to find ways to connect anthropology to people who don't necessarily want to read ethnographies or even go to a, watch a documentary film or go to an exhibition. I'm trying to find ways to make those things more accessible and inclusive. And so, the whole goal is to do the social science work and have it be rigorous and I would hope meaningful, but also to have it be of broad interest to a general public, because I think right now, we are in a moment where now more than ever we need anthropologists who are in the public kind of psyche talking about these issues and helping us to understand why the world is the way that it is.
Definitely. I think your work really speaks to that. And Angela, can you tell us a little bit about what you've been working on?
So I work both in New Mexico, which is where I'm from, but also in Mexico. So on both sides of the border. And but actually my sort of perspective on the brutality of our immigration system comes primarily from my advocacy work, which is unseen by students and faculty here at Stanford for the most part. And so I work a lot with legal programs and nonprofits that are focused on immigrant rights. And one of the things that I've been trying to do is to sort of be attentive to the sorts of language that we use. For example, calling ICE detention centers as detention centers, as processing centers, as hold rooms, et cetera, and really talking about them as prisons, because I think they are prisons, and the people inside of them certainly think they're prisons. And my interest in this partly comes from personal relationships, but also through this advocacy work. And what brought me to the advocacy work were attorneys who actually read my book, which has really nothing to do with immigration, but had certain sensibilities and insight that they thought would be useful, particularly my work in Mexico City now, some articles that I published. So basically, I have been working on these cases, writing expert testimonies that or declarations that come from a kind of very close reading of people's lives through various documents, and then sort of drawing a picture and saying, what is likely to happen to them should they be deported. So I have to make Mexico look terrible, basically, which is a weird thing to do to try to keep someone in this country. But what I'm also very aware of are the brutalities of our own system and the kinds of abuses people in these, who are incarcerated in these immigration, detention centers supposedly are susceptible to and have experienced everything from just beatings, humiliation, withholding of medical attention, life-saving medication, especially for LGBTQ and women, and people with chronic illness, mental illness, et cetera. So while I talk about the dangers of being returned to Mexico, I'm so aware of the dangers that exist here in this system. Now, especially perhaps with COVID, and that is coming up in some of the cases that I've been working on. So I think what I want to say is that, and the brutality of the system also, of course, is our policy-sanctioned programs that really began the separation of families, et cetera, things that we're well aware of. I think though that I want to say, the situation at the border, at the US-Mexico border is not new, and it's not exclusive to that border. And this is a global phenomenon where governments are really working to deter immigrants and to deny asylum. And so the thing that brings me here is an interest in what do we do as anthropologists? What do we do as scholars of literature and film, as the students are who are joining us? And my answer, I think right now, is we have to disturb people. We have to sort of send them a jolt. And I think increasingly that academic scholarship in the traditional sense doesn't do a very good job of that, because I think it requires a kind of visceral response. And I see work like Hostile Terrain 94 as an example of something that's a work of art, but not only a work of art, that it's actually a form of aesthetic form that embodies the condition that it's speaking about and speaking to. And I think that embodiment of the condition helps us to recognize the violence that made that picture possible, made that art piece possible. And I think that it's not just art that can do that, it's also ethnography and the way that we approach writing, how we teach as professors, et cetera. So I'm really interested in work that intervenes politically through an aesthetic sort of entry point. And I think that that's really important. And as scholars, as anthropologists, we haven't harnessed that enough and have sometimes looked down upon it. So I wanna talk, hopefully we can address that as well.
Thank you. And I think that's a great point to really dig into, is that idea of what anthropologists are doing and how they're disseminating or not disseminating to the public. And so I just wanted to get a sense of what you both think, if the field is doing this, or if there's too much emphasis on sort of the book, the article that's not reaching the public, and other mediums that you're talking about, the artistic, the documentary film, are better suited for sort of bringing these topics to light and really engaging with a wider audience to get these types of topics in the public conversation.
Well, you know, I think just to build on Angela's, I think really important point is, I'm always shocked when ethnography is not visceral, because the world that I know out there that exists, the world that that people are engaging with, is a visceral world. And yet we, I think oftentimes do push back a lot when things are too visceral. It makes the academy uncomfortable. People who are invested in a certain type of writing, in a certain type of scholarship that's inaccessible. I think, you know, there's a lot of gatekeepers who get very uncomfortable with the critique of that style, and who get very uncomfortable when something comes at them that should be, I think, embraced as part of the canon of what we consider to be ethnography. But yet it looks too different. And it's often, I think, a lot of times written by people of color. It's oftentimes written by, non-heterosexual white men. And I think that these other perspectives that have always been marginalized in the academy make people uncomfortable. And so the critique has been like, it's too much, it's too visceral, or these questions like, well, who is really your audience? I always think about the things that I get, the pushback I get are oftentimes, those kinds of questions, which for me are just veiled critiques of, why aren't you doing what we want you to be doing? Why aren't you making things that we think you should be making? And I don't think that we have any more, I have no patience for that anymore. I really don't. And I was sort of trained to, I read all that stuff. And then when I finally had to start working on my own thing, I knew that that was the exact opposite of what I wanted to do. And so I think that the system in a lot of ways is set up to reward certain types of anthropology and really be dismissive of other types of anthropology. Not just, I mean, I think we could start with ethnography and ethnographic writing, because I think everybody has to do that at once, at the beginning stage to get promoted. And then after tenure, then you're allowed to explore other kinds of forms of scholarship. And yet I think also we're still very dismissive of the exhibition, the documentary film. I think the assumption is that a documentary film or an exhibition are much easier to do and require less intellectual work than writing another ethnography, which I think is a total copy. And those are things that are said to people who don't make exhibitions, who don't make films. But I had a pushback all the way through with every single thing that I wanted to do. And it wasn't until there was a recognition that, like, oh, maybe this is something that is of value by other people or by deans, then suddenly my own department or colleagues would then look back and go, oh yeah, we told you this was a good idea, this was really working, even though these are the same people in the beginning who were like, this is not what you should be doing, you're not going to get tenure, this is like an inappropriate sort of use of your time. And I as far as I'm concerned, I think we need to be really rethinking that completely from the beginning. It shouldn't be post tenure where you're allowed to push and to be visceral and to explore kinds of things. It's a huge system that I think needs to be changed.
Yeah, well, I couldn't agree more. And, you know, my own work has been called or derided as overly sentimental, anti-intellectual, you know, all of these things. And it's really, you know, I continue to engage with, you know, my scholarly community, but I also find that well, for example, my next book is going to be published with a trade publisher. I'm not publishing it with an academic publisher because of my desire to speak to a broader audience. And I will say it is the most difficult thing I've ever written, because having to put all of this through image and to really think about writing in a much more heightened way, you know, and to not be able to fall back so easily on theory, it has been a real challenge for me, and a good one. And it makes me think about some of the limitations in our discipline and the way that we write, and not just write, but engage with the world. Who are we talking to? You know, that's really important to me. And I think, but one thing I really want to stress also is that I would really like to see the university recognize that the commitments, particularly of anthropologists of color, are worthwhile. And often they're just like, oh, she's more of an activist than an anthropologist. You know, this even happens at the level of admissions. So I think that rather than just seeing it as activism, which I have no problem with, but actually to see it as a commitment that is deeply, that's necessary. And these are certain commitments that I think anthropologists and scholars of color perhaps have more, that we, you know, take them, we see them as valuable. And whether that's, you know, commitment to exploring other ways of, you know, reaching people beyond text, but through art, film, what have you, or if it's, you know, working in your community at a grassroots level, to see that those experiences also inform our thought and make us, I think, better thinkers and better writers and more able, I believe, to touch readers or viewers in a way that is also embodied and not just all at the level of the head.
You know, and I think I too am currently writing a trade book, which I find both debilitating and frightening, and then also liberating in a lot of ways. And it's been, you know, as you say, like, it's for me, it's been a really interesting exercise to think about, okay, theory is important for me, but it's important for me to understand the world in certain ways. It's always been important at like a kind of ground level. Like, can I explain, like I've always wanted to start from the bottom and then work my way up and to see whether or not theory can help me to understand things that I'm looking at, as opposed to, you know, I'm committed to this theoretical perspective and now I'm going to find some poor village to force into this paradigm. It's been a really interesting exercise for me to think about, you know, at one, as you say, like, what are the things that I would lean on to, you know, as a way to, it's like kind of a shield, like, okay, well, you know, writing is so hard, and it can be such an emotional kind of thing, but, you know, you can fall back on certain perspectives, certain types of certain stuff, you know, you can have like, here's the ethnography, it's got the kind of, here's the blood and guts, and then here is the theory and the history and the background and the methods or whatever. those sections, I think, are a lot, the theoretical section, the background section, those are hard, you know, sort of intellectually, but they never come close to me in terms of like the difficulty of, okay, can I tell a good story about the world through an anthropological lens? And can I do it in a way that's ethically, you know, that's sensitive, that's, but also, you know, also in, engaging. And I do feel like anthropology is like, I don't think it's because maybe it is because I'm super biased, but I think that also we have, I mean, we're the most interesting perspectives on human existence. And yet we have not been very imaginative in terms of how can we convey these experiences, especially through writing. I mean, I just feel like, you know, and I've really had to fight against, yeah, your work is, my people saying it's too visceral, it's too atheoretical, you're dumbing it down, you know, it should be more impenetrable, you know, all whatever, you know, they don't say that, but whatever the language of, you know, of the academy. And I think that those things are it's so much easier to write, to make something in that's indecipherable. It's so easy to be like exclusionary and to kind of be isolated within the ivory tower. And maybe that's a reason that that people push back against other stuff, because they maybe secretly recognize that to do this more public work, to maintain the kind of anthropological lens in a more accessible kind of public facing way, we've never been trained to do it. And it's, I think it's a hell of a lot harder. And then the stakes are a lot higher. I mean, you can fail, you can write a shitty ethnographic academic book. I mean, there's a lot of those out there. And that's not, I mean, but you know, as long as it gets the you know, the right press, you know, and press is what, you know, they lose money on these books, that, you know, it can be a super boring book that nobody ever wants to read. It's a print of 1,000 books or 500, and then that's it. But you can still get tenure on that stuff. But failing with, I think, a trade book, or even succeeding with a trade book, is potentially a way to also to sabotage yourself, because the academy, I think, doesn't know what to do with that. And for me, that's incredibly bothersome, especially right now when the world is on fire. And I turn on the news to hear about, you know, some expert about race or class or gender or sexuality, and it's not an anthropologist, right? It's just some other clown who doesn't have the credentials, but has the vocabulary, and perhaps, you know, well, I see all these books written about like anthropology by non-anthropologists, and it kills me that has become the expert voice of our discipline. In this moment right now, where I think we really need our smartest people being more committed to these kinds of issues. And, but also, I mean, I think we need to reward people early on and need to really start this conversation early. So it's not like, oh, post tenure, you can start to kind of play around and be more and have more fun. It should be something, I think, early. I mean, for me, all of the public outreach stuff I've always wanted to do from the very beginning, and I had to hide it for so long and then sneak it in. And I think that we need to do better by students and by junior faculty to say, if this is part of your profile, if this is part of your commitment, then we should be rewarding you early on and helping you to better do these things, because we need it now more than ever.
Yeah, I'll just say one more thing, and that is that what Jason is describing is an exclusionary system. And that is also what our immigration system is. It's exclusionary. It's, you know, take these people, they don't count, throw them away, you know, get them out of here. You know, send them home. And I think that there are many anthropologists who cannot be exclusionary. You know, we just can't, because of our families, because of our community. And that leads, I think, to a different kind of, experience, certainly as a faculty member, but also there's a potential there to not be exclusionary. That's, you know, I think potentially very powerful. And I just hope that, you know, I and Jason can sort of begin to make some inroads as, you know, anthropology has not always been irrelevant. I mean, think about Margaret Mead and Ruth Benedict and, you know, Boas. There was a period where anthropologists were public intellectuals. So I think that hopefully we're entering a period where anthropologists are reaching a broader public. But that actually take some risks, but you know, it's not possible or acceptable for me to just cut off my ties with my world, which is a world that has not gone to college, that does not ever ask me about what I do, you know, and that doesn't matter what I do. So, you know, it just, it's, yeah, I, there just aren't enough of us, I think, which speaks to a broader problem.
And I think this is a good time to bring in more of us, two students here at Stanford, John Ayon Alonso and Ekelin Ho. John is an MFA here and Ekelin is a junior undergraduate here. And both of them were involved with putting the Hostile Terrain 94 at the Anderson Collection exhibit up and filling out the tags that are part of it, as well as contributing to a publication that was put out, a pamphlet by the Anderson Collection. If you hadn't had a chance to see it, the anderson.stanford.edu, anderson.stanford.edu, you can find on the Hostile Terrain 94 exhibit page, a pamphlet. Both John and Ekelin have pieces in there, and I'll just give them a chance to introduce themselves. John, can you introduce yourself and tell us a little bit about your what you're working on and your involvement with this project?
Yes, hi. First of all, thank you to Jason and Angela for such amazing words. They were really inspiring for me as a MFA candidate in the documentary film program here at Stanford. My work has been basically only about immigration and the generational trauma of immigration. Both of my parents were immigrants, my mother from El Salvador, my dad from San Luis, Sonora, Mexico, which is coincidentally right on the border, right next to the border. It's split. It's San Luis is a town that's split by the border, much like Nogales, where I basically spent most of my childhood living there with my aunt, spending a lot of time there with my family, and knowing full well that along that border in that desert during my childhood, there were people dying to get across, dying to get to a position of freedom that my parents were able to, I'm not going to say the word enjoy, but able to experience. And so when I heard about Hostile Terrain, thanks to Koji's work to get the Anderson to bring it to their collection and Jason De Leon's book, Land of a Thousand Graves, I just immediately felt the need to somehow participate in the process. And so I've been very grateful to be able to film some time-lapse footage. I've been able to put up some tags, fill them out, and also just participate in the process of documenting these deaths and watching Jason's film Border South 2 as a documentarian was a super inspirational moment this year. So I've just been really grateful to be a participant in the project and be able to have conversations about what's happening in the Sonoran Desert and along the Arizona-Mexico border, because it's something a lot of people don't think about. It's something a lot of people don't want to acknowledge, the massive amounts of deaths that our forced determinant policies have enabled and created. So thanks for having me here.
Thank you, John. And Ekelin, if you can tell us a little bit about yourself and how you got involved with this.
Of course, thank you, Koji, and thank you, Jason and Angela, for your provocative conversation. My involvement with Hostile Terrain 94 had been facilitated by the Student Guide Program, whereby Stanford students offer tours of artworks from the Anderson Collection and the Kenter Art Center. I had written about Hostile Terrain 94 comparatively with Philip Guston's The Coast 2 from the Anderson Collection. Both of them eyes resist human with filling out toe tag to prepare. In the Border Patrol's dehumanizing process, the numbers in boxes, just as how the government and the law abstract humans to parasitic statistics or identification cards that they will never get. Therefore, the impact of Hostile Terrain 94 for me lay not only in the confrontation it stages between the viewers and the heartbreaking data from Humane Borders, but also in the self-interrogation it necessitates when we pick someone up in our hands and know that they can't be reduced to this orange or manila toe tag, but that they have been, and we have allowed them to be. So this installation, unlike a graph on a PowerPoint or in an academic journal, does not allow us to be insulated from zero tolerance policies and states of exception that have reduced humans to bare lives. And Guston's The Coat 2, which I also wrote about, operates similarly in that although it is inspired by Gogol's story, The Overcoat, which critiques the synecdochic displacement object, it does not replicate the human reification in Gogol's story. The coat is not taxidermied, but is morphological. The bottom hem of it becomes two planks of wood nailed together. The sleeves appear stiff and fleshy all at once, and the shoes are semblances of bread. So Guston ruptures the status quo, and I believe both The Coat 2 and Hostile Terrain 94 disturb political fictions and animate the objectified. They also expect this from our conceptions of and participation in history and what's to become of it.
Thank you, Eklund. And I think that that sort of brings us to a question. You know, one of the trending topics, of course, right now, and a lot of the focus is on the presidential election. But a lot of these policies sort of have transcended both Democrat and Republican administrations along our border. And so I'm just sort of curious to get your thoughts about how you think this presidential election, is it sort of taking up all the oxygen in the room and really taking focus off while these same types of violences are happening at the US border? Or do you see sort of inroads that can be made at this political moment? And that goes out to all of our panelists who want to jump in.
I just got a text that Georgia is now tied Trump and Biden, which is great. But I also, you know, I can't remember who it was. I think it was Van Jones who talked about, you know, we may have a political victory, but we don't have a moral or ethical one. And we could see that in the numbers, really the astonishing numbers of people who voted for Trump. And so I think that in order for there to be, I believe with Biden, there will be some improvements, but until there's a radical, you know, just some really like hard look inward ethically and morally, there can never be the kind of change we would like to see. And so, again, that's where I think art and writing can become so, that are so central to the possibility of opening up a moral or ethical space for reflection. When you see the toe tags and you see how congested they are and how they're layered layer upon layer upon layer, you have a feeling that something is just not right. That, as Eklund said, you don't get with a graph, you know, or a talking head. So, we have a lot of soul searching to do, I think, even with the Biden administration. That's my opinion. I'm glad they're tied in Georgia.
I mean, I think in some ways, like if we had had a Hillary Clinton presidency, there would be so many of these issues that we would have just be ignoring, that, like, you know, all the things like Obama being the deporter in chief, all the things that had happened under Clinton, that people weren't, they were very good at masking. They were very good at sort of downplaying, or, hey, let's throw Latinos a bone here and totally ignore what's going on in other places. I think Trump's total disregard for everybody, and letting people like Stephen Miller just run the show, and actually now saying out loud and ramping up the brutality that had been going on for a long time, I think in some ways, you know, that was good for a part of America's conscience to go, oh my God, I didn't realize that it was this bad. But it also highlights the fact that there's half this country that could care less. They don't care about babies in cages. They don't care about the police shooting Black people. They don't care about any of these things. And it doesn't matter how bad it gets and what you show them, those folks cannot be convinced to care about these things. And so, you know, I think you're totally right. No matter what happens in the next week or month, God help us, whoever's in the White House at the end of January, you know, these issues have to still be at the forefront. And, you know, and part of, like, Hostile Terrain 94 was me reacting to the fact that there had been all these deaths that had been occurring, but Trump was just creating new dumpster fires that were totally distracting from these things that I felt like were finally getting traction, or he was carrying out new forms of just horror that now it wasn't, we weren't now just concerned about migrant death and, like, deportation. Now it's like migrant death, deportation, child separation, the cancellation of people's ability to apply for asylum. So, you know, I think that we took a whole bunch of steps back with Trump, but it opened up some people's eyes. And I think no matter what happens next, I don't want the energy and the anger that we have right now to go away, because I feel like we could get, because it's like, as long as you don't say something super crazy and racist like Trump does, you come across as, like, semi-rational, right? Even though so many Democrats are implicated in prevention through deterrence, implicated in all of the stuff that's happened in Central America for decades that have led to these problems. But I, you know, I don't want us to, like, we have this monster in the room. We get rid of the monster. Now there's this other thing in the room that maybe has a veneer that's not as scary, but, you know, in some ways that's, you know, can mask all of these things. So I hope that, you know, if we do have Biden in the White House, that it'll still inspire people to start now really pushing back. And, you know, the Black Lives Matter movement for me has been so inspiring to see all the students right now, even during this pandemic, who've come out and said, I'm mad. I'm going to participate in civil disobedience. I'm going to find ways to engage with people, even if I have to do it virtually. I really hope that energy maintains, because we're going to need it. You know, you're totally right. Until we start dismantling these things and really pushing back, as opposed to just being like, okay, now everything's great. We're totally happy, because it's not, we're no longer putting babies in cages. I think if we go back to that, we're gonna just go back to the status quo. And so I hope we can keep up this energy.
Yeah, I would really like to see the criminal justice reform movement, the movement to, you know, end mass incarceration, also think about immigrant incarceration, and for there to be a better, you know, a real conversation between the two, and see that there are, you know, natural alliances and allegiances between those two issues. I also want to say, you know, even if all of those kids, and I hope to God they are released from, you know, their own incarceration and are reunited with their families, there is still going to be trauma that is going to, you know, I think there will be generations of it. From our current policies, there will be generations of trauma that will be felt. So even if Biden makes incremental important changes and, you know, Trump is booted and, you know, the policies begin to change, it's not going to be felt that, you know, for those who have gone through this trauma, you know, it's going to continue to live on for some time. And I think that that's something that we don't often think about, is how it becomes embodied and then shared within families. And really, as someone who works on mental health issues and addiction, I see the intergenerational aspect of this very clearly.
Yeah, to add to that, that's basically what my work is to study how this trauma manifests itself intergenerationally within all children of immigrants, people who are affected by the diaspora. Right now we have a situation, as Jason and Angela have mentioned, that has been going on for a long time. I think, you know, there's this notion in the world or in politics in general, I think, that we've adopted that immigration is this complex issue. It's complicated, or it's some sort of third rail politically. And the reality is it's not very complicated. We spend so much money on immigration deterrence, on border policies, on border patrol, on the wall. And if that money could somehow go into building infrastructures in Central America, in Mexico, to help people not feel the need to leave. We have this idea, and I think in our country, that people are coming here because they want to make more money. And that idea needs to be dismantled, because that's not the reality. Right now, there is a hurricane, Hurricane Ida, that's devastating El Salvador, Nicaragua, Honduras, Guatemala. Like, it's devastating Central American people right now, because they have no infrastructure to protect themselves from things like this. And it's on its way to Cuba. And poverty in and of itself it seems to people in this country, I feel like this is some sort of get rich quick scheme. If you cross the border, they're going there to make money and send it back to their homes and family. But the reality is we, as Jason and Angela have mentioned, we went into those countries and we've destroyed their economy. We've destroyed their infrastructures. And so it's a matter of life and death. And I think that's why Hostile Terrain's 94 as an art installation, as an experience that we all have to witness and see the impossibility of getting to this country for these people, is still worth the risk of death to them, is the most important thing that we should all be reflecting on. And as Angela was saying, what happens once they get here, once they survive the trauma of that journey, and they have families here, and they try their best, and yet they're still criminalized by the system that has created the funnel of the siphon, if you will, to bring them here in the first place, is one of the most traumatic experiences anyone can go through, in my opinion. And then that gets handed down. It gets handed down generation after generation, and there's no explanation, and there's no conversation within these homes. And a lot of these homes are silent. They're silent. We don't know. I don't know why, ultimate to this day, why my mom does the things that she does. I just know that she doesn't want to talk about what happened in El Salvador. And so here we are in this moment where, as Jason mentioned, people are going to continue to mask the monster in the room, behind the monster in the room, if you will. There was like a Wizard of Oz reference there to me. There's someone pulling the levers that we're not paying attention to, because we're just distracted by the mouthpiece of hatred and bigotry. So I think that the work of art installations, anthropology, everything mixed in together, ethnography, film, these are the ways that we are helping build a critical thinking spine in the public, I think, to have conversations about this and to realize that it's not that complicated in the end.
Of course, and I think it's also important to realize that as we are becoming distracted by each new crisis, that's just an additional intersection for the people who, you know, feel the economic pull to migrate, and then, as John mentioned, to be criminalized, to, you know, be incarcerated in ICE, et cetera. So each time, whether it's presidential election or COVID, all of these are just additional intersections and exacerbations of their condition. So it's impossible really to forget, because it only worsens instead of disappears.
I want to just remind people to drop some questions into the Q&A. We're getting towards the last sort of half hour of our conversation here. And I want to bring in a question. This quarter, I've been co-teaching a class with Gina Hernandez on the Hostile Terrain exhibit. We've been talking about these themes, and John's also been with us teaching these themes of migration and activism. And one of the students had submitted a question asking about centering the voices of migrants in your work, and how do you sort of approach that as you do, you know, we hear a lot about people speaking for, and I think Jason in the past in our conversations, you talked about this sort of disconnect where people don't necessarily need people to speak for them, people need to listen. And so I'm just want to get your perspectives on the mediums that you work with. How do you make sure to center these voices and perspectives?
You know, I think that's one of the challenges. I think a challenge that artists who sort of engage with anthropological work, I think in some ways are at a disadvantage compared to anthropologists who then engage with artistic work. Because I feel like within anthropology, right, we're working very hard to, I would hope, to center the voice of the people that we work with. And then we're trying to find ways that, whether that's through writing about them and giving them a voice through the writing and letting them speak for themselves in writing, or incorporating their voices into exhibitions or other platforms. We sort of start with that. And I've worked with artists in the past where it began with, like, I'm an artist who has an interest in immigration, but I don't speak Spanish. I have no connection to this issue. That for me has always been incredibly challenging. And it's probably the reason that I don't now collaborate with outside artists who don't have some connection to this, because I just felt like oftentimes we were having too much of a discussion about aesthetics. And I wanted to have more of a discussion about how does voice create the aesthetic? And you know, there was a bit of that was a struggle when I was working with outside artists. And so now, you know, with the work, you know, I've been able to collaborate with people who are sort of attuned to both things, the anthropology and the artistic practice. And, you know, we come to the conversation saying the number one question we have at every meeting and every, design conversation, it's about, okay, how do people fit into this whole thing? Can we do this without the voices of migrants? And if so, why are we doing it? Like, because I question that a lot. And so what I've tried to do is, in Hostile Terrain, the version that's up now, the final version, which we're going to launch in a month, it would allow you to scan the exhibition wall, the toe tags, with your phone, and you'll be able to hear the voices of migrants, talk to an avatar about their experiences in the desert, talk to the families of the missing and of the deceased. And so that was us for us to have a way to, you create this exhibition through group participation, collaboration, but then also finding ways to then bring those voices back into it. And so that's always a struggle, is figuring out how, in these different mediums that I'm sort of in charge of editing, and I I'm the person who controls the kind of final product. It's always figuring out then how can people be for at the forefront of this whole thing. So that for us and our team, that's a constant conversation. And it's just, you know, and the same thing with the writing. It's always like, how do I don't want to paraphrase this story or paraphrase this voice. I want this voice to be upfront. But, you know, that can be a struggle with the ethnographic writing, because you have expectations about how does one, you know, write theoretically, but then also include voice of someone else. And of course, I don't think we train anthropologists in any of these things. So we're all kind of doing it, you know, figuring out as we go.
Yeah, I agree. We are kind of scrambling to figure out how to do this. But I also just want to say, you know, one of the things that we need to do, I believe, is also really learn what it means to listen. And when we really learn what it means to listen and develop that skill, which I believe is actually a skill, it's not like we can really hear people just by sitting in front of them. It requires time and patience and humility. Then there's no possibility of not putting that, you know, narrative at the forefront, I think. And the other thing is that there are a lot of first person narratives that are coming out now in memoirs and novels written by people who have gone through this experience of crossing the border, or of being in detention. And we need to buy those books and support those writers. And fold that material into our writing, and to not see it as secondary or even you know, not even secondary. So I think listening, which includes reading, which is humility and all of those things. I mean, I keep kind of coming back to the question of, you know, having an ethical shift as being really necessary for there to be any sort of meaningful change. And I do think that that shift is really possible through art and through writing, and that is really based on that is based on listening to each other. I mean, I don't want this to sound Pollyannish, but I really think that we don't teach our students really how to write. Well, maybe we do, but I think that it's okay to write poorly and to, you know, just say the right names. But we also we have methods courses that really don't address the question of listening and how essential that is to our basically our craft. And that's something that I think is essential for all of us as well. So I'm gonna have a course on listening that I'm gonna give it hopefully eventually. So when we're not on Zoom.
We have a lot of questions coming in, and so I want to try to get as many as we can in the time we have left. A question for Jason about the design of the installation. They ask about the artwork installation in relation to images of migration and the death of migrants in the news and other media, and what informed your decision to use tags with names rather than images in sort of designing hostile terrain?
Well, as someone who takes a lot of photos, I think with this particular project, my collaborator and I have probably taken over 20,000 images, and we probably only published 70. You know, we end up sitting on a lot of these images because we don't know what to do with them. I don't take pictures oftentimes. I mean, we have photographed the dead on rare occasions. And even on rare occasions, we've made decisions to publish some of those images. The publication of the dead is something that, you know, requires a lot of context. And I think you have to have a very good rationale and a lot of permission, not just from, you know, the medical examiner, but from the family of folks. And so, you know, with this exhibition, we want to push back against, you know, you can just type in dead migrant on the internet and just see a thousand horrible images, and I just feel like we're completely desensitized to those things. And you know, and especially like in the wake of the kid in Turkey, whose name I'm blanking on now, you know, when we were designing this exhibition, it was kind of on the right after that stuff had happened. And I was just like, you would think an image, you know, my thinking is always like, can an image change everybody? If you see this one troubling image, can it change the world? And I think, unfortunately, not. We live in a world where we see lots of troubling images all the time, and we go about our daily business. And so with hostile terrain, I really wanted to put the onus on the participants. So people come in and commit themselves to being a witness for the dead through their own labor. So taking a digital Excel spreadsheet and then making something out of it with their own handwriting. For me, I thought that was a way more meaningful way to connect with this issue than just here are some images that are troubling. You know, and I hope that the writing out of the names of the dead will stick with someone longer than you know, one of these graphic images that they might see. I mean, that we'll wait and see if that is the case, but I at least wanted to find a different kind of way to raise awareness about this issue without having it be, you know, completely graphic and at times really exploitative and often difficult to control the context of the image. So, you know, that's been the decision. But if you look at like all of the exhibition work that we've done, we've always been very cautious about the images that we publish of migrants themselves. We publish lots of other photos of the desert and of material culture, but I'm always quite hesitant. I mean, I have to have a very good reason to show a picture of someone of a person who is in the midst of all this stuff, because I know that that's such low hanging fruit, and there's a million other projects that are doing that. And so, you know, I'm always trying to make sure that I'm not just reproducing the things that I find to be so problematic in other places.
There are a couple questions coming in about sort of anthropology and advocacy, and where do you envision both an anthropology as advocacy and activism, as well as an anthropology that moves away from an extraction model. So anthropologists as mining communities. How do you see sort of the discipline moving forward from these older ways of, or certain ways of doing anthropology to ones that are not extractive, build trust and work towards activism and advocacy?
Well, I think one of the things that's really exciting about our discipline is how many people of color are deciding to become anthropologists and women. It's always been a field with women, you know, kind of at the forefront of a lot of things. So I think one way to not be extractive is to not be exclusionary. And to recognize that we do have something to offer that is not just something that builds our own CV, you know, and that we, for example, the work I do with nonprofit legal organizations is not going to ever count when I go up for promotion, you know, but it's something that I do every Monday. And it's something that I'm committed to regardless. And that work is informed by my anthropology. It's informed by it, and then it informs it. So it's not like one or the other. They're very much embedded, but the way they're seen by the institution is that they're separate. And I just don't think that many of us work in that manner. And that, you know, I would love for there to be more acknowledgement of how advocacy work is just as important as field work, that it is a form of field work, you know, and that there it's a resource for thinking and for creating and as art and other ways of being kind of in the world and being, you know, creating things, whether it's a, you know, expert testimony or a work of art, you know, these are meaningful projects that shape our thinking, our teaching, and but are under recognized. And I think that that's part of our job, you know, Jason and I and other anthropologists that may be tuning in, like that's part of our work that we have in front of us.
I would just add one thing to that. I think if you can make something that connects with people beyond, you know, your discipline, I think that is activism. I think that is advocacy. I mean, I don't refer to my own work and using those terms, even though I know that it's doing those things. I just want to do anthropology that means something to people, and not just the people who are going to review me for promotion, but mean something to the people that I work with, people that I collaborate with, and then also, you know, people out in the world. And you know, advocacy, activism, public anthropology, those have been bad words for a long time in the discipline. And we've been really dismissive of those things. I mean, for a decade, I've been called those things, but not in a good way. You know, when someone says, for a long time, when I was at a previous institution that won't be named, although they did just go turn blue, that state, Michigan, when people would call me there a public anthropologist, that was not a good thing. You know, that was a really kind of dismissive term. And I think now we're starting to see that that is such important work for us to all be doing. And, you know, I think that you can have the best of both worlds. You can do rigorous, you know, in-depth ethnography, but also have it be accessible. And through those things, then it becomes a catalyst for change. It starts to activate people who read it and go, oh, now I want to learn more about this. Now I want to get involved with these sorts of things. And so I think that we can do an anthropology that does all those things without having to get caught up in the nomenclature, you know, and we can embrace it, I think, in a way that I would hope would be really positive. And I'm actually hopeful right now that we're living in this interdisciplinary moment where students are so smart and savvy about, you know, the world is complex. And so I want to find all these different ways to kind of express myself. And I don't want to be pigeonholed by one discipline. I think that we have that going on. And we also have people responding to a million different dumpster fires that are happening around the world. And so it's also inspiring kind of creativity to say, okay, I want to do all of these things at once, and I want to do it in a way that then is broadly understandable. And underneath those rubrics, we can throw in activism, advocacy, public intellectualism. I think it feels like we're moving beyond having those conversations now about like what to label it, and recognizing that like this is what we should be doing.
And sticking with this sort of theme of language and a point that Angela made earlier when she first introduced herself about what we're calling detention centers and not calling them prisons, a audience member asks about the verbiage we use and describe undocumented border crossers, if that's, it feels dehumanizing and abstract. Is there a way we should be talking about or integrating our writing with a verbiage or a language that is more engaged and more helpful for humanizing?
I think the question of language is so important. And, you know, I have to dabble in the language when I'm doing, you know, the sort of advocacy legal work that I do. And I'm always struck by how the lawyers that I work with who are really committed to immigration law, nevertheless, work within this administrative language, you know, that it, you know, not critically, you know, it's like a reproduction of the language, even though they're trying to make change, they're still using the language that kind of classifies certain people and acts in a particular kind of way that is really, not at all connected to actual experience of the people that they're advocating on behalf of. So, you know, most of the people that I have worked with and that I have known have kind of jokingly just referred to themselves as people without paper. And they say it kind of both with some anxiety, but also with some humor, because it shows the ridiculousness of this dehumanizing system that we have. To be without paper is to not have an identity. And to not have an identity is to mean that you can be put in a cage, right? So language is something that, you know, I definitely grapple with and that I think is incredibly important. And we just always need to be working toward being more precise, not in the administrative sense or necessarily the scholarly sense, but more precise in terms of the experiential of, you know, who we're working with and, you know, writing about. Take their lead.
And there are so many more questions that have been trickling in, but unfortunately we are coming up to the end of our program tonight. So I want to start answering a few of them with our closing remarks. So we're going to start with Jason first. People have been asking what the future of Hostile Terrain 94 is, how they can still be involved at this point, or if they can, and where they can watch films like Border South. So if you want to just throw all answers to those questions and tell us where people can find out more about your work.
So you can learn about us on all the various social media platforms the kids are using these days. So Facebook, Instagram, Twitter. I don't think we're on TikTok yet, but our social media team is quite younger than me, so that we probably will be there soon. But if you go check us out on the internet, undocumentedimmigrationproject.org, hostileterrain94.org, or find our Facebook pages or any of those other accounts, you can learn about all of the virtual programming that we're doing. We are now running a monthly webinar where we talk about all things related to anthropology, art, migration, et cetera, et cetera. I will probably hit up many of our panelists here for that in the near future as we're starting to plan for next year. Our websites are conduits for other Hostile Terrain 94 hosts that are doing lots of virtual events. I believe that we've got two or three next week that I'm probably involved with. I think there's like, and those are all on our website. So you can go and look, and many of those are virtual conversations or screenings of Border South. So a lot of our hosts are doing rolling kinds of open public screenings of Border South that you can connect with on the internet, or just send us an email and we'll get back to you with more information about that stuff. Hostel 2094, so we've done maybe 15 or 16 either virtual or hybrid virtual physical shows. Some of them are still up right now. There's a couple in Europe that'll be up until January. We've got actually one in New Mexico that should be up until February. But we're anticipating, as soon as we get through COVID, whenever that is, that the rest of these shows will launch physically. And so we're looking at about 125 locations that have yet to open. And those shows will potentially go into the end of 2021, if not 2022. So there's lots of places that shows are going to happen, including California. I do believe we have at least one Northern California show that'll happen next year, and multiple Southern California shows. So just go to our website and you can get info there. Or just drop us an email and we'll get back to you. And then finally, if people want to get involved now, we are in the midst of it's called the Digital Moment of Global Remembrance, where we are looking for 3,364 volunteers to make either audio or video recordings of themselves reading out the names of the dead. And so you can still participate right now. I think we're at about 1,800, so we still have a long ways to go. I'm gonna just play a quick 1 minute video to give you a sense of what it looks like, and you can see how to participate, but also you can get the info on our website.
Name, unidentified. Age, unknown. Reporting date, September 5th, 2010. Cause of death, undetermined.
Alfonso Salas Villagrán, edad 64 años. Fecha del informe, 22 de agosto de 2006. Causa de la muerte, cardiopatía.
Name. David Orocho Fobo, Alter 20. Meldedatum 28. September 2004. Todesursache: Verletzung durch stumpfe Gewalt.
Thank you, Jason. And Angela, where can people follow up and follow your work from here?
You can just look at Angela Garcia Stanford Anthropology and see my publications, and hopefully my new book will be out in, well, I shouldn't say, it's taking me a long time. But I could definitely be found through the Stanford Anthropology website.
Thank you. And John, where can folks find more of your work?
My work can be found on johnione.com. You can probably follow me on Twitter or IG or whatever with at johnione film. I'll just post it here real quick. And yeah, I'm finishing up my thesis year right now, and I'm actually working on a film about Oscar Alberto Martinez Ramirez, who was the father and daughter, Valeria, Angie Valeria, who was found in the Rio Grande. And there was a tragic photo taken of them about last summer, tracking their journey to the camp in Matamoros and what they found there when they arrived. And so that's going to be my thesis film, which I'm working on right now. But you can follow that website that I added, and you can watch my old film, Sombras, which is what got me into Stanford. That's it. Thank you for having me, though.
Thank you, John. And Eklin, if you're still here, I can't see your video right now. If there's any work you have that people can find or you'd like to share, where can folks find it?
of course, people can feel free to read my essay that compares Hostel 394 and Gust in the online catalog. And I also want to take this opportunity to urge people to donate if that's within your capacity, and if people would like more resources to get better involved, please also feel free to just shoot me an email, which would just be my first name at stanford.edu, and I'd be happy to recommend any resources or organizations.
Well, thank you, and thank you all. Thank you to our panelists who I think carried on a really important and engaging conversation this evening, and to all of you who came and attended with us. And I'm sorry we couldn't get to so many questions. I almost wish we had 2 hours instead of the hour 15.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Good night.